Rita, the floor is yours.
Hello. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Firstly, I want to thank the organizers for organizing this event. It's a nice event, and to get to know each other, what we mean to say in this in and around Trieste. I think it's a very nice initiative, and hopefully we will get to know each other's work better in through Zoom, and maybe it start new conversations. So and so I want to so today I'm going to like speak on revisiting Mazur and Suzuki Bound for finite systems. So and so what I'm going to focus mostly on is the applications of it in for transport and integrable systems. So this work is done by with my PhD supervisor Abhishek Dhar and also KG Saito, and it's roughly based on the on the work which is shown here. So this is going to be the rough overview of my talk. So first I'm going to talk some bits about transport and integrable systems. I'll talk about the setup and the common setup and typical features of transport and integrable system. Then I'm going to talk about like autocorrelation functions and try to motivate from there why autocorrelation functions are important. Then I'm going to discuss Mazur and inequality and Suzuki equality. Then I'm going to talk about how to go from the inequality to the equality. And then I'm going to discuss some few simple examples, a single harmonic oscillator, quartic oscillator, and then I'm going to move on to many body systems. So, I mean, I'll explain what each of these terms says in the letter. And So one thing I should mention here that I'm going to, quite contrary to the other things, I'm going to focus my whole talk on classical systems. So first I'm going to say suppose we have a system, a 1D system, and you have n particles, and then you have this each of the particles have this position q and momentum p, and typically a 1D system will have this Hamiltonian with the quadratic momentum and this potential. And say suppose, and they are interacting with some potential v. And say suppose you consider the system to be isolated, you consider them to be in the periodic boundary condition. And typically the form of this potential determines what kind of transport you have in the system. So for example, a special case can happen for a special choice of this potential, the system can be integrable. Integrable one means that it has n degrees of freedom, n degrees of freedom with the momentum of the position, and then for a special choice of potential, it has n independent constants of motion. But that is that you can construct some function of this p and q such that the time derivative of it is zero. And independent means that between the two constants of motion, the Poisson bracket is zero. So a typical example, a very common example of a many body integrable system is just the plain and simple harmonic oscillator. As most of you know, but there is for example another non-trivial example of an integrable classical system, which is if you have this potential to be an exponential and also nearest neighbor interacting. So this is what is called the total potential, and it's also integrable. A typical example of a non-integrable system is, say, suppose if you take nearest neighbor interaction, but with a quadratic and a quartic term. So it's what's called an FPO beta system. And for this for this non-integrable system, the typical conserved quantities are, if you consider them in the periodic lattice, you have this total inverse density as constant, you have the total momentum as the constant, and of course you have the Hamiltonian, which is the constant of motion. But other than that, you do not have any constants of motion. But for integrable system, you have, for n degrees of freedom, you can construct macroscopic number of conserved quantities. So suppose somebody gave you a system and asked you like, is the system integrable or not? I mean, rather than doing any calculation, it's not a priori very easy to say if the system is integrable. But what you can, typically integrable system has typical signatures in transport properties, which you can put in a computer and see and test and see that if the system is showing shows some integrable properties. So one of it is like, if you can consider equilibrium fluctuations. So suppose you take the integrable system and you perturb this integrable system somewhere, and you observe how this perturbation spreads in space and time. And typically what one finds in an integrable system is that the perturbation spreads in both space and time. And then if you rescale the spread of correlation in space and time by x by t and t here, they all collapse onto each other. So this is what is called the ballistic scaling. So integrable system typically has this ballistic scaling, although there are exceptions, but typically this is what is seen. So this is one aspect. And the other aspect, what one can do is like study the non-equilibrium transport. So suppose you take this integrable system and you connect the system to heat bath, and you take the, then put the, connect the left end of the system at a higher temperature and the right end at the lower temperature, and you drive the system out of the equilibrium. There's an energy flow from the hotter end to the cooler end. And the system will reach some kind of steady state. And typically what one finds is that if the system is integrable, you have, say, suppose, for example, here you put in the left end a temperature of 2 and the right end temperature of 1. For an integrable system, typically you find that the temperature in the bulk is just flat. It does not have any structure, which is like a very contrasting to some other systems. Say for a typical non-integrable system, you will have if you measure the temperature in the bulk, you will have a temperature which is continuously interpolating between the hotter end to the cooler end. So a typically flat temperature profile indicates that there is some kind of underlying integrable structure in this system. And also given the setup, one can also construct this, study the thermal conductivity of the system, which is this kappa. And the thermal conductivity is typically given by the amount of current flowing across the system divided by the applied temperature gradient that is there. And typically this gives the kappa, and for an integrable system, this J by delta T is just a constant. And so the thermal conductivity basically diverges linearly with system size. This is in contrast to, say, for a typical non-integrable system where the thermal conductivity is not dependent on system size, it is a constant for regular material. So what I'm going to try to say is that we can also construct this thermal conductivity through another kind of experiment, through the equilibrium fluctuation, which is through the like the Green-Kubo formula. So the linear response theory tells that, say, suppose you again now take the system in equilibrium and you study how the you take the fluctuations of the current operator, the autocorrelation of the current operator, and you try to understand and you compute this integral, the correlation of the autocorrelation function, and Green-Kubo says that the thermal conductivity is given by this formula. And say suppose in an integrable system, if you plot this quantity as a function of time, what you see is it decays. It starts from some value and decays to some constant here. And this constant is not zero. And so if this is not zero, then this integral basically diverge, and it diverges as n as a system size. So you see, so what I've been trying to motivate is that this kind of autocorrelation function is important for understanding transport in integrable systems, and for our talk, what we'll try to focus on is this autocorrelation functions of some observable, say A, which are functions of the momentum and the position, and we'll focus on this quantity CA, which is the time average autocorrelation function. So the long time value of this is what is called the Drude weight, and in the literature, and we'll try to try to estimate basically what is this long time saturation value of this of this autocorrelation function in terms of the constants of motion of the system. So this autocorrelation function also have we have already seen that this autocorrelation function is important to understand the transport coefficient of the Green-Kubo form through the Green-Kubo formula. By studying this autocorrelation function, you can also studying this autocorrelation function, you can basically distinguish if the system is integrable or not by putting a bound, like if the autocorrelation function do not decays to a constant, then it possibly has a ballistic component of the transport and hence integrable. And also it provides insights into the ergodic property of this variable A that you are considering for the system. So these are some of the references that that discusses this quantity. Let me come to this Mazur inequality. So what does Mazur say? So suppose you have this Hamiltonian system, which has R conserved quantity undergoing Hamiltonian dynamics. And let's say you denote this R conserved quantities as this I1, I2 to IR. And for simplicity, this I1 is, say the Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian is always a conserved quantity. And for some purpose, let's say that we subtract the average out. And because this average is anyway a time independent quantity, so we can always do that. And let's say we define this conserved quantity so that the average of this conserved quantity is zero. The average is denoted is with respect to this initial ensemble, and this is the Gibbs ensemble, and with the temperature, the inverse temperature beta, and let's say we construct this correlation functions of this conserved quantities I1 to IR, and call this matrix Vij. So what Mazur says is that Mazur constructed this quantity, which we denote as dA, and which basically says that is this projection of this operate of this observable, and we are interested in this long time dynamics of this observable A. So it says that this quantity as defined here is always is bound basically this this large long time correlation functions of the observable A. So what it says is that the long time correlation function decay to some constant, and that constant is always greater or equal to this quantity dA. And this was proved long time back in 1969. And what one typically expects is that, like, if in an integrable system, if one considers the set of all conserved quantities, say if I have like in an integrable system, if I have 10 conserved quantities, and if I include all the 10 conserved quantities in the system, this should be an equality. Like the long time saturation should be equal to the value provided by this Mazur. Yeah. But what it was seen in some previous studies in classical systems is that it was not enough to saturate the bound by including all the conserved quantities, but also one had to include the bilinear combinations of the conserved quantities in order to saturate the bound. So this is the paper that I am aware of, the first work in this direction. And this is also a recent work which addresses this problem in quantum systems. And okay, so Mazur did this calculation for classical systems, and what Suzuki published in 1971 was that he took a quantum system with discrete spectra, and in that case, in a quantum system with discrete spectra, a trivial set of eigen constants of motion are this projection operator of the energy eigenstates. And what Suzuki proved was that the long time saturation value of this autocorrelation function, which is the CA, is exactly equal to this projection of this observable on this eigenstates. And this is an exact equality. So this basically, so let me explain to you a bit more about, like, so this quantity CKL is again this correlations of this this conserved quantity in the initial ensemble, and these quantities are basically the expectation value of the conserved quantity with the observable that we are trying to find the large time value of. And this is quite interesting formula, because you see that in this, so you're basically getting, we basically get the large time saturation value of a dynamical problem without ever having to run the dynamics. So this is a completely static, like one can compute this from the statics, and basically it gives a bound to this large time behavior of this autocorrelation function. And for example, and for here the number of eigenstates that one needs to consider is proportional to the dimension of the Hilbert space that one is considering. And for, say, suppose an infinite dimensional problem, we have to consider this sum for all the eigenstates to infinity. But a more general theorem of the, corresponding to this Suzuki bound, where you have both discrete and continuous spectra, was proved here. And so now the question is that how do we reconcile this two different? So Suzuki proves that this autopolarization function exactly decays to this thing and this quantity here. And Mazur proves that it is lower bounded by this quantity d. So the question that we try to ask is that, is that the equivalent of the Suzuki equality in classical system? And the answer that we try to like we find is that like it is possible to attain this equality, like, but for the equality what as seen in the previous study, we have to include when computing this this projections of the observable to the conserved quantities, we not only have to consider the first the conserved quantities, the linearly independent conserved quantities of the system, but we also need to consider the product of this conserved quantity. So we have the conserved quantity I1, I2 to IR, but we have to also consider I1 square, I1, I2, so on and so forth, and then this an infinite set. And if we use that infinite set, what one can show is that then this long time value of this integration of this autopolarization function is equal to this quantity, where this where now all these averages are now constructed over a general Gibbs ensemble, which with all these conserved quantities as ik, and this lambda k are the corresponding Lagrange multiplier of the system. So the main point here being the difference is that it's not sufficient to take the first r conserved quantities of this system, but also take bilinear or higher order combinations of this conserved quantity in order to saturate this bar. And so in order to explain this in more details, I think it would be first let us like consider this example of this like a simple harmonic oscillator. It's a one simple harmonic oscillator in order to see that how this is true. So this, it has this Hamiltonian, it has this momentum and the position v square and x square. And now let us, and you can solve this explicitly, you have this solution in terms of initial condition. And say suppose you take the system in an initial ensemble of e to the power beta h with the beta as your inverse temperature. And let's say you are interested in this observable a is equal to x square. Now with this solution, you can compute explicitly what is this autopolarization function CA, which is integration of zero to tau dt, and this quantity x square. You can plug it in and do all the integration and then take an average. And what you find is that it is equal to two x square whole square. Now you can, so you needed the whole solution of this problem with the time and everything to compute this. Now, but you can also compute this this bound from by considering the set of say the only conserved quantity as the Hamiltonian, and using this formula, the projection of x squared into the Hamiltonian. So you take x squared into this whole Hamiltonian and take the expectation value, and then divide it by the Hamiltonian square and its expectation value, and you find that these two are exactly equal. So for this quadratic observable, the CA is equal to DA. That is the long time saturation value is exactly given by the marginal value, and hence the equality is satisfied. But for example, you consider an observable which is x to the power 4. These are really simple, like you can just do it by hand, and like x to the power 4. And then what you see is that you can again do this integral, and you find that the long term saturation value is 54x square whole to the power 4. And now you try to see that if you get this number from by considering this Maslow formula, but by with only the Hamiltonian, because the Hamiltonian is only the conserved quantity, and you find that if you plug everything in, like you plug x4 and h here, and you find this quantity is 81 by 2x square whole 4, and they do not match. But now you take, you introduce also while computing this value, you introduce h and also h square, and you compute explicitly, and you see that it matches with the long time value. Okay, here it will be a 4, and there's some mistake here. And it matches explicitly. So the point is that like it's necessary to consider not only the conserved quantity, but also the conserved quantity square. And initially it looks a bit weird, but also a conserved quantity square is also a conserved quantity of the system. And it kind of makes sense. So the second example that we can consider is this like single quartic oscillator. Again, you have this just one particle, you have this momentum and position, and this is nonlinear, and it's again prepared in this ensemble minus beta h. But now you cannot solve it explicitly, so you can solve this dynamics and put it in a computer and solve it. And let's say suppose you take this observable x square, and you compute the autocorrelation function. The autocorrelation function looks something like this. It does some initial oscillations in the beginning and then saturates to some non-zero value. And this non-zero value here is, if you do the integral, it's something like 0.63. And what you find is that like, then you compute the Maslow value with say only the Hamilton. This one here is included to subtract off the averages. But it's just a descaling. So suppose you take the Hamiltonian, then you get the value to be 0.60 something. Then you take Hamiltonian square, you improve the bound a bit. Then you take higher combinations, and then you keep on increasing. So you see that the bound keeps on increasing as we include more and more higher powers of the conserved quantity. And finally, if you like, as in Suzuki's bound, if you take an infinite number of this thing, this will be equal to this long time saturation value. And one can kind of show this explicitly. So the main takeaway message from this studying this single body problem is that if when the potential is harmonic, always a finite number of conserved quantity is sufficient to saturate the bound, but the number of conserved quantities required to saturate the bound depends on the degree of observable that one is studying. For example, as we have seen that for x4 we needed h square, but for x square it was satisfied by only taking the Hamiltonian. And for the nonlinear case, what typically one needs an infinite number of conserved variables to saturate the bound. But however, as we have seen, as we can see here, like the convergence is really fast, like the effect of taking three conserved quantities and four conserved quantities, the difference is very less. So it converges quite fast to the long-term value. So this was a part, I hope this is more or less clear what I'm trying to do. So if there are any questions, please ask now. Otherwise, I'll try to move on to the many-body system. Okay, so
sorry, maybe I have one very short question.
Yeah.
That okay. In some system, some system, but maybe not in one particle, so maybe I'm getting ahead of myself there, but some system cannot be completely characterized by conserved quantity only, and there are these quasi-conserved quantities that has to be taken into account as well. Do what you are about to say also concern these type of systems or not?
I'm not very familiar with the quasi-conserved quantity system, and I have not, okay. I do not know what exactly it means. But if it is conserved in the dynamics, in some sense, I mean, this discussion can also be taken over to quantum systems. And here I'm discussing classical system, but I guess it should hold in this more general statement.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so now we'll try to discuss what happens in our many-body system. So what one can show is that if the many-body system is like a quadratic many-body system, like there's a chain of harmonic oscillators nearest neighbor interacting, and one is interested in just observing quadratic variables, then the long-time saturation value CA is always equal to the Mazur value computed just by taking the Hamiltonian. And it's always equal irrespective of the fact if the system is classical or quantum. But this kind of like follows from the single harmonic oscillator problem. Which is consistent with the one that we had seen in the single harmonic oscillator problem. But what is more complex is more interesting is that when we consider this kind of system, which is the total lattice, we consider this n particle total lattice, where you have this momentum p, and they are interacting with each other with nearest neighbor interaction, with an exponential form, and what one can show is that the when one writes down the equation of motion of this system, it can be written in terms of this. The equation of motion of the system can be written as something like this, like in terms of this matrix L and M, where L is this matrix with the diagonals as the momentum and the off diagonals as this exponential part, and the M is constructed as the upper part of this triangle minus the lower part of this triangle, and this is what is typically called the Lattice pair, and the equation of motion can be written as the time evolution of this matrix as a commutator of M and L. And so given this form of equation of motion, what one can show is that the system has conserved quantities which are trace of L to the power N. So you take this matrix L and L to raise it to power N and then trace over, and these are all in constants of motion. So they do not evolve in time with this Hamiltonian dynamics. So this is what is written here. So you take L to the power N and you take the trace, which is the II. And then one can check, like if you do this, then trivially the first conserved quantity of the system is the diagonal element, which is the total momentum. The second one is the Hamiltonian. And also you have, if you take the system in a periodic boundary condition, you have the total density to be conserved. And now one can now what we can study is say we study this observable. I mean, these are important in terms in the study of heat transport. So we study the total momentum current of the system and the total energy current of the system. And we say, suppose we define this quantity An, which is this quantity, which is say the momentum current minus the average value of it. This average now is all taken over this general Gibbs ensemble with e to the power minus beta H plus P into the density. P is kind of the pressure and beta is the inverse temperature. And for example, and then one can compute this this autocorrelation function of this quantity An using molecular dynamic simulation, and then try to compare this with the value of the Mazur bound that is provided by considering the conserved, all the conserved quantities. So, and now we consider these two sets. The first set here consists of considering only the first n conserved quantities of the system, and the second set consists of considering the first n conserved quantities of the system and also the bilinear combinations of them. So you have In, and then you have this set which has In and In, and you can compute the the Mazur value of this observable An using this set I1 and also this set I2, and we'll try to see numerically what that how well this two matches with this long time saturation value of the CA obtained from molecular dynamic simulation. So here is the first plot. So this A1 is the momentum current and A2 is the energy current, and this 1 by N comes from some considerations of because we are taking here the total sum. And so what we see is that if we consider, so this is the long time saturation value as obtained from this molecular dynamic simulation, this curve, this violet curve, and the Mazur value as obtained by taking just the firstly we are considering a total lattice with four sides, like there are four particles. And for this four particles, you can have all the conserved quantities explicitly, and if you just consider the first four conserved quantities, the Mazur bound is given something here. While if you consider the four conserved quantities and their bilinear combination, the Mazur value improves and becomes almost exact to this long-term saturation value. And the similar thing happens for the energy autocorrelation function. So now if you increase the system size to 8, you see again, if you consider the bilinear combination, the value is exactly equal to the long time saturation value of this autocorrelation function. But if you take just the first 8 conserved quantities of the system, it's still far from the saturation. And a similar thing happens with n is equal to 10. But what you can see is that the gap between the two keeps on decreasing as we increase the system size for both. So and you can compute this and this gap basically decreases as with system size, with increasing system size as 1 over n. So this makes it plausible that in the thermodynamic limit, possibly this the bound, like the saturation value is can be possibly given by just considering the the thermal the constants of motion of just the constants of motion of the system. But for any finite system, we that last time saturation value should, if you have to get an equality, we have to include all the higher order combinations of this conserved quantity. So CA is equal to DA, which includes all the combinations of conserved quantity. And it is plausible that in the thermodynamic limit, we don't need to consider the, it's enough to consider just the conserved quantities of the system and not binomial terms. But this is just a numerical evidence, but one needs to prove this more rigorously. And yes, so this brings an end to my talk. So I'll summarize briefly what I have discussed. Like, firstly, we address the question, like when in classical system, the Mazur inequality becomes an equality. That is when the long time saturation value of autocorrelation functions is exactly equal to the bound computed in equilibrium through the projection to conserved quantities. And we found that it is for a finite system, we need to consider not the conserved quantity, but also higher combinations of conserved quantity in order to saturate the bound. And for a many body system, the difference between for considering the higher order contribution to the bound decreases as 1/n. And so what one is interested in is that a more detailed understanding of this 1/n contribution in both classical and quantum systems. Like how does it decrease as we increase the system size, and what is the effective reasoning for this 1/n dependence? And I want to mention here that I discuss everything in classical system, but this is also seen in the quantum systems, and which we also discuss in the paper. But yeah. So this brings an end to my talk, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Aritra, for this nice talk. I clap on behalf of the audience, and we now have plenty of time for questions. So please go ahead.
Yeah.
So maybe I could start. Is your estimation of this long time average always a lower bound, or is it not the case? In that, if you keep on adding more and more terms to your set of conserved quantities, is it always increasing, or that's not the case? This was my observation from your plots, but.
So what we could prove is that if you keep on in a certain way, if you construct this, if you keep on adding this more conserved quantities, like you have this n independent conserved quantities, and then you take products and cubes and cross products, then you basically always increase the bound and you get more and more accurate. You basically get more and more accurate as you increase the bound, as you increase the number of conserved quantities. But does that answer the question?
Okay. But then, so is it always the case that the value you get is increasing with increasing number of conserved quantities, or this is just a coincidence from those plots? So if you let's say
it always increases.
Okay, so there is no way that it could overestimate the long time value and then decrease if you add more.
No.
Okay.
If you add the conserved quantities in certain way, you cannot add in certain way. It always improves the bound. Right. This was shown in the paper that we discussed. Yeah.
Okay, so there is another question by Vladan Celebonowicz, if I'm pronouncing correctly, whether can you give a one or two introductory references to your subject?
I think it's I think it's best to first. Oh no, what happened? Did my slide close?
Yeah, I believe you have to share your screen again to share your screen again.
Okay, I think my keynote. I think the best introductory reference is, to study the papers of Mazur and Suzuki, and they're the best. So. I would say that just a minute. Let me try to share. Can it be seen?
Yes.
I think these two are very nice references. They're old papers, but they are very nice. The Mazur's paper, original, and this paper by Van Kempen. And also this Suzuki's paper. And there are a lot of interesting things going on here. And for more, there are these studies which are now being done in quantum systems and in regarding the Eisenstadt thermalization hypothesis, which has similar things that are being studied there, here they have studied. Okay, I don't know. Yeah, I think. I mean, here they have studied this. They have studied this Mazur law for the XXZ chain. Use the Mazur law to prove ballistic transport in the XXZ chain. This is also a nice paper, and yeah, that's what I can say. And you can also look at the references given in this paper. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So let us wait a little bit more for maybe another question, because we still have
so maybe I have a brief question while some people might be typing it. It's when you move on to the quantum case, are there some significant difference in the demonstration, and in this case, where specifically, or overall, does everything adapt without notable changes?
No, in the quantum case, it's a bit more subtle, because, like, for example, Suzuki proved the systems quantum case, it's, Suzuki proved it for a system with a discrete spectra, but in general, you can have discrete and continuous spectra both. I mean, then things becomes more complicated and more mathematically challenging. And this was kind of, I do not understand it completely well, but this was addressed in this paper by Prozen and others. And it's not so straightforward, I would say. It's not so straightforward, yes. I mean, and I think people are working on this actively in quantum systems and around this. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Shraddha has a question, so please go ahead.
Maybe Shraddha, I can give you the right to talk. Give me a second. Now you should be able to talk.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pierre, for giving me the right to talk. So I have a very trivial question. So it's just like this, that if you have a long range interacting system, do you need less number of higher orders of these conserved quantities? Or, I mean, can you comment about this maybe?
If you have a long range system.
For example, if you keep on increasing the range of interaction in the system, maybe you need lesser number of conserved quantities or lesser order of, so rather than going to four orders, you just need maybe two orders of, two higher orders of these quantities.
I mean, that's an interesting question. I mean, you're talking about many body long range systems.
And I
do not know the answer, but I guess I do not know. One has to just see. I mean, it depends on what you are considering, which observable you are considering, and what type of long range. I mean, suppose if you have an infinitely
interacting.
Then sometimes this model can be like very simply mapped to a single body problem, right? And then you would possibly need higher order conservation laws.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
All right, so I don't see further questions appearing. Thank you, Aritra, for this talk. And I would like to thank all of the speakers of this session.